famine. Georges-Jacques Dantan was born in 1759 at Arcis-sur-Aube, in the lush countryside of the Champagne region. He grew up a boisterous farm boy and remained a countryman at heart, sucking milk straight from the cow's udder, attacked when he was two by an irate bull who gashed his face with a horn. It gave Dantan the pug face and lip carved into what looked like a permanent sneer. He played truant from school, swam in the river, ran wild in the fields, got a good education, came to love Latin and French literature. Of the great French tragedian whose lofty drama greatly inspired Charlotte Corday, Dantan said, "Corneille was a thoroughgoing republican." Dantan, a man of bustling energy, high animal spirits and acute intelligence, typifies the kind of men who made the revolution. A coalition of the educated and the ambitious, shunted into limited and trivial careers, their considerable gifts cheated of wider recognition by the exclusive protocols of old regime France, the France of an absolute monarchy bolstered by intransigent belief in the divine right of kings. Voltaire had cautioned against giving the vote too freely to those not equipped mentally or socially to cope with it. "All is lost," he wrote, "once the people entangles itself in reasoning." But the indignant frustrations of men like Dantan were a vital spur to revolution. "The old regime," he said, "made a crucial error. I was educated by it as an exhibitioner at the Collège du Plessis. I studied there with great nobles who lived with me on equal terms. My studies over, I was left high and dry. My former schoolfellows turned their backs on me. The revolution came. I and all those like me threw ourselves into it. The old regime drove us to it by giving us a good education without opening any opportunity for our talents." He studied law and was called to the bar at Reims, where the necessary certificates were cheap to buy. Moved to Paris, drank and played dominoes at the Café du Parnasse on the right bank by the Pont Neuf, and married Gabrielle Charpentier, the wealthy proprietor's daughter. With her dowry and loans, he bought the legal practice and entree to the law courts of maître, master, the honorific title of a lawyer, hué, and was launched. He and Gabrielle lived in the Cour du Commerce in the Latin Quarter, very near an old Franciscan convent, by then disused, in the Rue de l'École de Médecine. In its large refectory took place the meetings and debates of one of the foremost political clubs in the city, the Society of the Friends of the Rights of Men and Citizens, attended by all the patriots of the district, the Cordeliers, after the nickname of the Franciscan friars. This district, just south of the river, part of the old medieval city, an ill-lit, pokey labyrinth of narrow venals and criss-cross streets no wider than alleys, was a known hotbed of anarchists, a nest of truculent revolutionaries intransigently opposed to all authority. The Cordeliers were predominantly publishers, journalists, writers, booksellers and people of the theatre. Amongst them, the most outspoken partisans, men who played a central role in the revolution. One such, Jean-Paul Marat, the people's friend, author of a vitriolic journal of that name. Another, Camille Desmoulins, the progressive journalist. He and his wife, Lucille, were particular friends of the Dantons. The cafes, restaurants and taverns of the Cordeliers district, centred on the club, were hotbeds of radical thinking, heated talk, revolutionary fervour, polemical writing, the doctrines of social and political change, fermented by a potent mixed society of convinced intellectuals and impatient artisans. Desmoulins, addressing his readers as "my dear subscribers," encouraged the notion that the Cordeliers district was the true heart of the revolution, the home of the honest men who worked actively for its integrity, its universal good, its protection without fear or favour of the rights of all men and women, in stark contrast with the self-seeking, self-serving men of both the royal government and the commune, the municipal authority of Paris. In the Cordeliers district, the Republic of Ideas and Ideals had been brought into being. Even when the city's 60 districts were reorganized into 48 sections, the Cordeliers remained the center of political influence on the left bank. Across the river, The Jacobins, who met in the former friary of the Dominican order, named Jacobins for the Rue Saint-Jacques in which their parent house stood, were closer to the heart of government. They had a more prestigious membership, though Marat and Danton belonged there too. And the rivalry between the two most powerful political clubs in Paris came, in part, to identify the war of factions within the revolution. One of the Jacobins was a lawyer from Arras, the small town near the Belgian border which gave its name to a popular form of tapestry hanging. Maximilien Robespierre was born on the 6th of May 1758. On the 16th of July 1764, when he was but 6 years old, his mother, who had been pregnant all his short life with his brother Augustin and two sisters, Charlotte and Henriette, died having just given birth to a fifth child who did not survive. She was 28. Was it she who taught her eldest son how to make lace? Her father did not attend her funeral, and a few months after it left the family home for good. The two boys were taken in by their maternal grandfather, and Maximilien was soon packed off to the local Oratorian school, where he was taught that man was made to adore God, and that God, the central pivot of all creation, did not exist to oblige or serve man. In 1769, young Robespierre enrolled at the college Louis le Grand in Paris. Former old boys included Voltaire and the Marquis de Sade, and students there with Robespierre included Desmoulins and Lebrun, who became Minister of War after the 10th of August 1792. The daily routine had remained unchanged since the school was run by the Jesuits. Morning, 5:30, rise, 6, prayer, 6:15, study of Holy Scripture, 7:15, breakfast and recreation, 8:15, class and studies, 10:30, mass, 11, studies, noon, dinner and recreation, afternoon and evening, 1:15, studies and class, 4:30, snack and recreation, 5, studies and class, 7:15, supper and recreation, 8:45, prayer, 9, bed. This was the pattern of his life for 11 years until he left the college aged 23. He graduated in jurisprudence in 1780 and a year later was awarded a degree at the University of Paris. These qualifications permitted him to be enrolled in the register of lawyers attached to the Parliament of Paris. He returned to Arras and practised as a barrister, on one occasion delivering an impassioned panegyric on England in defence of an Englishwoman arrested on charges of debt. On the evening of 13th of July 1789, a lawyer called Lavaux attended a meeting of the Cordeliers where a speaker harangued the audience from a table, telling them, in a tone of high rage, that the citizens must take up arms to repulse the 15,000 brigands mustered in Montmartre and an army of 30,000 which is preparing to pour into Paris to loot and massacre. His whole demeanour was fanatical, and he ranted on and on and on until he was hoarse and spent. The man was an old friend of Lavaux's, Danton, whom he had always taken to be a rather peaceable, jovial, carefree fellow. But the times were neither peaceable nor carefree. In 1787, an assembly of notables, hand-picked to eliminate troublemakers, had brusquely dismissed plans for much-needed fiscal reform and demanded a meeting of the Estates General, a sort of parliament called at the king's bidding, which had not met since 1614. This, in the opinion of many, was the only true national assembly, and only such a body, representing the whole nation, could agree to wholesale changes in taxation. The Estates General comprised elected members of the three estates, the first, the clergy, second, nobility, third, the commoners, who had always been denied partnership in the Parlement, the sovereign courts established to render justice in the last resort in the king's name. The third estate, on whom fell the heaviest weight of taxation, yet ordinarily had no say, was demanding to be heard. Under Louis XIV, the gossip went, no one dared speak. Under Louis XV, they whispered. Under Louis XVI, they talked aloud. The Abbé Sieyès, one of the leading theorists of revolutionary principles, put the point succinctly in his famous pamphlet, What is the Third Estate? January 1789. What is the Third Estate? Everything. What has it been until the present time? Nothing. What does it ask? To become something. Acceding to the pressure of calls for reform, the king summoned a meeting of the Estates General in January 1789. Elected deputies of all three estates had convened on 5th of May. There was much talk and no action. On June the 17th, the third estate, exasperated with the glaring insincerity of their partners in this supposed democracy, robustly declared that they alone embodied the true National Assembly, and on 20th of June swore an oath on the tennis court at Versailles to remain in session until a constitution had been established. The king reverted to type. Such defiance from the lower orders could not go unchecked. He gave orders summoning an army of 30,000 to Paris, and by the 4th of July the troops were encamped in the city and the surrounding area. It was neither a remedy nor an answer. On Saturday the 12th of July, crowds invaded the theatres and forced them to close. Dragoons tried to restore order. A mob occupied the Tuileries Palace. Paris was like a powder keg and the fuse was lit. That same day, Danton's friend Desmoulins addressed an expectant crowd in open-necked shirts gathered outside the Café Foy in the Palais Royal, whose gardens Philippe Duc d'Orléans, the king's cousin, had opened to the people of Paris. He had also ingratiated himself by making periodic doles of bread. The Palais Royal gardens, enjoying Orléans' privileged royal status, were a sort of free enclave within Paris, flanked with cafes, haunted by prostitutes, rabble-rousers and intellectual agitators, seething with seditious talk. Desmoulins bade his audience, "Listen! Listen to the voices of Paris and Lyon, of Rouen and Bordeaux, of Calais and Marseille. From end to end of the nation there is one united cry. We want to be free." Free from what, exactly? Of a total population of around 26 million in 1789, only about 4.3 million lived in towns, and of them 700,000 in Paris. This lopsided aspect of the demography was reflected in an equally lopsided caste in society, where the divisions cut by privilege, wealth and power made France effectively two nations, the enfranchised minority of the two estates and the rest. The greatest burden of taxation lay on those least able to support it. The poor were required to pay royal tax, church tax, as well as dues to their local lords, the nobles. Since many individuals, crushed by this financial burden, had grown adept at evasion, and most were suspected of it, tolls were often levied on communities as a whole rather than on its individual members. This meant that those who were solvent had to stump up to cover the shortfall from what the insolvent would not or could not contribute. It was a sort of welfare system imposed by a greedy central authority. The king and his royal tax collectors were indifferent. So long as they got their money, they did not care at whose expense it came. The most flagrant inequality operated in the levy of the gabelle, the hated tax on salt, a royal monopoly which was levied per capita on a pre-assessed and obligatory consumption, a poll tax in other words. Every citizen was required to take salt and pay for it, no exceptions. However, the kingdom was divided into six regions of the gabelle, five paying substantially different levels of taxation and one entirely exempt, relative to the availability of salt from salt mines and the ease of manufacture in salt pans. The royal salt houses took a varying proportion of the regional production by way of sanction. Cross-border smugglers were active. The collection of taxes was the responsibility of the royal tax farm, a syndicate of private shareholders who leased a monopoly on the levy of all indirect taxation by contract with the king, renewable every 6 years. The tax farmers were among the richest men in France and hated for it. Like the Roman publicani, the publicans of the Bible, they mulcted the population in the name of the king and reaped a fat profit. Indirect taxes took the form of aide, customs duties paid by rich and poor alike, trait, stamp duty, octroi, local tolls on all goods and produce brought into a town, excise on the state monopolies of tobacco and salt, and numerous other imposts on trade and consumption. A contemporary joke has dinner party guests telling stories about thieves and thievery. It comes to Voltaire's turn. He begins, "There once was a tax farmer." Oh dear, I've forgotten the rest. In his polemic, The Wealth of Nations, 1776, the political economist Adam Smith wrote of the French excise system, "Those who consider the blood of the people as nothing in comparison with the revenue of a prince may perhaps approve of this method of levying taxes." France was a conglomerate of regions, each with a strong sense of identity, and many with a long history of independence from Paris, all straitjacketed into a vague idea of unity, but in fact totally at odds with itself. One, the Franche-Comté, free county, makes the point in its very name. The despotic rule of a Louis XIV, called the Sun King because everything in the kingdom revolved round him, might compel obedience, but his death let loose the forces of dissent. The entire structure, already teetering, began to collapse. His successor, Louis XIV, saw it coming and said, "After me, to hell with it." The inequalities of the tax structure merely underlined the creaking inadequacies of the entire fabric of administration. But these inequalities were most cuttingly felt and resented in the system of privileges by which successive monarchs had bought the loyalty of noble grandees who would otherwise have been disinclined to pay any degree of fealty to the king. In England, population around 8 million in 1790, there were 220 male peers of the realm. By contrast, in France, population about 26 million, there were some 25,000 noble families and altogether around 110,000 to 120,000 nobles, most very far from being rich, but not one who did not enjoy exemption, enshrined in ancient privilege, from most of the taxes visited on the poor. In 1788, when government expenditure totaled 630 million livres, over half the total was gobbled up in payment of interest on debt. The country was bankrupt by gross overexpenditure at court, the grievous toll of four wars waged between 1733 and 1783, by chronic financial maladministration, and yet still the nobles were exempted from taxes. Nobles also had the right to hunt at will over whatever land they owned. The tenants of their estates were required to pay in cash or kind a bewildering number of imposts, such as several bushes of oats annually, a tax on fire and smoke from the fire, stints of guard duty unpaid on the lord's chateau, latterly commuted to a cash fee in lieu, requirement to grind their grain, bake their bread, and press their fruit exclusively in the seigneurial mill, oven and wine press. There was also the hated annual corvée, to build or repair some 40,000 kilometres of royal roads, the best highways in Europe, a forced labourer of between 6 and 30, even 40 days, exacted exclusively from the inhabitants of peasant villages sited within 5 or 7.5 miles of the stone yards or the areas of reconstruction. As if the poor land workers did not work hard enough already at their own fraught subsistence. There was no central government as such. The king, remote and godlike in the court at Versailles, did nothing, which, according to sophisticated thought on enlightened despotism, entirely fitted his being and presence. He certainly did not concern himself with anything so vulgar as law. In 1789, France had altogether some 300 differing legal codes. Those in the south, based on paternalistic Roman law, with particularly restrictive inheritance and property rights, those of the north rooted in customary law, derived from the Frankish legal system. How could such a contradictory state of affairs be any real use in government? It was entirely to be expected that the main motive power of the revolution could come from hitherto obscure lawyers who seized the chance to transfer their pleading for justice in small town courtrooms to the bar of the national legislature, to make France governable by what they knew best, and, in some cases, all they knew, courtroom law. All royal office holders, whether in lucrative sinecures or appointments of significant power, held their place in the hierarchy of influence at whose apex sat the king. They paid money for place and power, and every significant position had its price. The king spent some 5% of the exchequer's annual revenue on the royal household, around 10,000 courtiers and servants. Versailles itself was the 10th largest town in France, with a population of 50,000. Since the majority of the people was ingrained with tradition, the popularity of the king's person was never much challenged, except by the one section of the people less awed by His Majesty, a large proportion of the population of Paris, but then only spasmodically. When the young Louis XVI and his queen emerged from the ancient cathedral in Reims, having been crowned and anointed with oil from the phial of sacred unguent bequeathed by Clovis, first king of the Franks, the people wept for joy. It was a very emotional, perhaps unthinking, but nevertheless highly charged popularity. He was a king of France and the French people entire, and as such he must be accorded all that made him their king, supreme, greatest king of all kings, the father and the saviour of the nation. But, bankrupted by a succession of wars and blighted by a series of disastrous harvests, that nation was poor, overtaxed and starving through famines which were often trumped in devastation by epidemics of smallpox and typhoid. Shallow ploughing, a poorly sown crop, a pestilence in sheep and pigs, the calamities of inclement weather, all might throw peasants who had nothing with which to pay taxes into vagabondage and mendicancy. From begging, it was a short descent to outright brigandage. And, when small holders were liable to be evicted at short notice by middlemen farmers to whom their rents were leased, the droves of landless agricultural labourers let loose on the countryside were a constant reminder of the age-old threat of rural violence, the so-called jacquerie, or peasant uprising, from Jacques James, the nickname for a peasant. Naturally, famine hit the poor hardest, and so frequent were the famines that the poor suspected a conspiracy of king and nobles to starve them, a famine pact. When grain flowed freely, the king and his aristocratic lackeys were clearly in cahoots with the conniving, avaricious profiteers who manipulated prices ruthlessly to worse those who had little enough to pay with anyway. When there was no grain at all, it was clear that the fatties with plenty to eat were, as ever, indulging in the odious machinations of self-interest, hoarding grain and depriving the poor who moaned in their distress, "The king is starving us." The king, the father of his people, saviour of the nation. The king was starving them. Arthur Young, the English writer travelling through France in 1788, made his own summation of the inequities of the nation. "The magic of property turns sand into gold. For the rest, it was dirt and thin air." Young met an old peasant woman in Champagne, who told him that her husband had only a small parcel of land, one cow and a crank horse, but they still had to pay a quit rent of 42 pounds of wheat and three chickens to one seigneur, and 168 pounds of oats, one chicken and one sou to pay to another, besides all the other taxes. She had seven children and used cow's milk to help pad out the soup. She told him, "It was said that something ought to be done by some great folks for such poor ones, but she did not know who nor how, but God send us better, because taxes, tolls and noble privileges are crushing us." Of the southwest region round Montauban he wrote, "One third of what I have seen in this province seems uncultivated, and nearly all of it in misery." He reported that bread prices in Abbeville and Amiens were 5 sous a pound for white bread and 3.5 to 4 sous for the common sort eaten by the poor, about a third of a daily subsistence wage. These rates are beyond their faculties and occasion great misery. At Meudon, just outside Paris, to the southwest, the police, that is to say the royal intendant, ordered that no wheat should be sold on the market without the person taking at the same time an equal quantity of barley. What a stupid and ridiculous regulation to lay obstacles on the supply in order to be better supplied, and to show the people the fears and apprehensions of government, creating thereby an alarm and raising the price at the very moment they wish to sink it. In Nangy, southeast of the city, he saw a party of dragoons drawn up across the market to prevent any outbreaks of violence. The people quarrel with the bakers, asserting the prices they demand for bread are beyond the proportion of wheat, and proceeding from words to scuffling, raise riot, and then run away with bread and wheat for nothing. The author of a pamphlet, "A Letter to the King," wrote, "Sire, it is the high cost of bread to which we must attribute our recent calamities.